Hey guys, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing. I'm here with my friend Jamie Ellis, who is one of the key behind the scenes guys in our sport. He owns a brand named Twisted Development, and he creates horsepower. But I was thinking about it this morning on the way here, and my first recollection of you is when we met was at Rockstar Energy Suzuki, correct?
And you were you used the shop for a couple photo shoots for Transworld back then.
But you were the, what was your role at Rockstar Energy Suzuki? Were you the engine builder?
Yeah, so I started off as a mechanic. I started there in 2000, at the end of 2008. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, when you're on a team, and that was an established team, we were around for a while, and a lot of the guys from that couple years of the team are still really successful in industry. So it's like, you never know what group you're a part of. You're just kind of doing it. But so I was a mechanic there for a couple years, and then the guy who was assembling the engines had kind of decided to go a different route. So I naturally moved into that position because I was already excited in doing it. Mm-hmm. And the owner, Bobby Hewitt, I was building Hunter Hewitt's engines the year before. So we're in the same shop because Bobby owned it all. It was very pretty interesting dynamic. Mm-hmm. But I had a corner of the shop where I worked on Hunter stuff. And there was always a difference between Hunter being on the team, not on the team. I think his best finish was sixth place at the Atlanta Supercross that year in 2011. So he was good enough to, you know, obviously run in a respectable spot, but whether it lined up sponsor-wise or his dad versus whatever. So I was already building Hunter's engines and we were on RMZ 250s. So whenever the engine builder took a different, the factory team's engine builder took a different position, that opened the door up for me to start building the engines. And then that turned into me becoming the crew chief and, you know, building the engines. So what year was it, 2010? Or 11 that we met up at the shop.
Oh, I don't remember. I think it was back then. Times.
I just remember the graphics of each bike
and
what I was working on. Like I can tell you the jetting we used in 2006 at Colorado. You know, like because that's like, but I think every mechanic has a favorite bike and also like some sort of a story behind. And that's how we even, like, I know how old my kids were based on where I was working or what I was working on. It's funny how bikes adapt all of our lives.
Yeah. Okay, so backing up from that, before I met you, how did you end up being a mechanic? And then obviously I've ridden with you, you're really fast, so were you a pro racer at one point?
So I grew up in Louisiana. The motocross scene isn't overly heavy there. We had a couple tracks, but I mean, I made money locally. I was never career based. I went to school to work on airplanes and helicopters. Mm-hmm. So went through A&P school. And then after that, the guy who did my motors and suspension, his name is Randall Harris out of Houston, was like, dude, I started a team. You got to come on the road with me. You just graduated. Like, just give me 1 year, 1 year, 1 year. And so I put all of my stuff in storage. I moved out of my house. And from that point forward, I pretty much was just on the road in this toter home scenario. Mm-hmm. And actually, the first year I worked for Jeff DeMint.
Okay.
So we did the East Coast Supercross Series. And then transitioned into Outdoor Nationals, where Jeff switched from a 250 to a 450. Mm-hmm. And then that eventually, I think he got hurt at Colorado, and that was kind of the end of that. So Tim Corky, you know, who drove for Pro Circuit for a long time, was super tight with Mitch and everybody else. But he's the one who actually introduced me to Dave Osterman.
Okay.
And Dave gave me an opportunity to move to California at the end of 2005. So I packed all my stuff, my pit bikes, my toolboxes, whatever I had, and I drove straight through. My old boss owns an oil company in Bakersfield. So I just drove straight to his place because I was working for him at the time. Slept there for the night and then finished the drive down to Valencia for Yamaha Troy. So I pretty much lived with Osterman for a month, figuring out what I was going to do. And then at that stage, moved in, found a couple buddies that also were mechanics, and we kind of, you know, teamed up.
So you were at Yamaha Troy?
Yeah.
Wow, I don't know why I don't remember that, but
I was
Andy
McFarland's mechanic.
Okay, Sharky.
So 2006. Yeah. And then I worked with Brett Metcalf at the US Open that year, which was the first aluminum frame Yamaha, and we won that race. It was pretty cool. So it's kind of funny, like I'm a Louisiana kid, I get to California, everything's new, it's cold at night, which is really weird because it just gets hotter and more bugs for us at night in Louisiana. So that whole process was really cool. I'm working on a brand new aluminum framed bike and And Frenchie at the time was the engine builder there. And yeah, so we all just kind of rallied up the box then, went, won the race within the first couple weeks I was there. So that was pretty cool. I mean, I was pretty much just turning the wrenches that Frenchie told me to turn at that stage. But yeah, that's kind of the path. Like, never really dreamed of having a job in the industry. I chose aviation because I wanted to travel. In Louisiana, where I'm from, there's a bunch of airports, and Boeing has a center there. You know, so it's really kind of popular to have some. You can work a job, go somewhere else, work a job, go somewhere else, work a job. So I kind of wanted to, A, those guys make more money, and then B, I like the idea of getting to see some scenario. Yeah. So that was pretty cool.
So you went to school to become a aviation mechanic.
Yeah.
But you never worked a day as one yet.
Never a day as one. And I don't plan on it.
Yeah. Was your whole motorcycle career, it's been in four strokes then, right?
Yeah, so adult-wise, you know, in my adult life, I grew up working on two strokes. I raced two strokes growing up back to your, I grew up through racing, started on 125s, and then was able to go through, every time I got a top 10 at a national, and it was primarily Ponca City, like I never did well at Loretta's or anything, but I'd get like ninth and 125 novice. And then I'm like, all right, moving up to the next class. And then I think I got eighth or ninth and 125 intermediate. And then I move up to the next class. And then so I kind of just kept doing that. Anytime I could consider it a top 10 at one of those bigger races, I would move on. So that was like a goal, meet it, achieve it, go on to the next. Sitting where I sit now and then looking back to that is like a whole different vantage point. And still yet, like a lot of these kids go really fast back there, but it's funny how people don't pay attention. Whenever you're a kid going through that process, you're like, a top 10 would mean everything. These guys are going to be calling, you know, and it's really for a pro team or at the level that these guys, factory teams compete, you know, you're looking for the cream of the crop, the special kids. And, there's a lot of really good kids that kind of go to the wayside as well.
From Suzuki, Rockstar Suzuki, you left. Is that when you started Twisted?
No. So I did the whole transition. We were Rockstar Suzuki, and then I was still the crew chief whenever we went to Rockstar KTM. So I was a crew chief, and I ran the team for the switch between Suzuki to KTM. So whenever we won the championship in 2014 with Jason Anderson, I was still with the team. And then that summer, I started Twisted Development. So it kind of took a different path. There was no job for me at KTM. I wasn't going to be in-house or building engines and kind of a free thinker and have my own ideas of how to do stuff. So I didn't really see that lining up. And so we kind of went different ways. And I started Twisted Development in 2014.
What inspired you to start your own thing?
Well, to be honest, opportunity. I felt like there was a lot there. I know I loved the development side of motorcycles and my kids. So I have two kids, they're 7 and 9 years old. And at that stage, you know, being a dad on the road is tough. Like you're gone 36 to 40 plus weekends a year. And those weekends are the moments you miss of the kids growing and everything they're doing, whether it be sports or whatever. So it's like, right now, my kids are 7 and 9 years old, and we ride bicycles together, we ride dirt bikes together, we play tennis, we play pickleball. I mean, anything you name it, like, I'm one of those big, big, big believers of, like, I'm a participant. I'm not a spectator. And if there's anything that I'm going to do, I want to be a part of it. I don't want to be on the sidelines, and that motivates me to stay with my kids and keep moving. And, and it's, they're at the age now where we're doing all of the fun stuff together. Like, they're turning into little me's, and they like the same stuff I like. And so we went snowboarding this year, you know? Like, if I was on a team, I wouldn't have been able to do that. So a lot of moments I feel that I wasn't willing to miss. And this, like, whenever we go to Mammoth in a couple weeks, I'll bring my kids, so it's their, like, yearly trip to go to Mammoth. And last year with COVID, it didn't happen, and they were gutted. You know, they, like, I want to create them some little merch, teach them about cost, teach them about, like, how to sell stuff and and whatever. We have the booth anyway, and they love it. So it's just kind of having some cool interaction. And once again, if I was a mechanic for a team and I brought my kids, it would be, like, taboo. Like, oh, it wasn't God bringing his kids. You know, you should have asked and begged for that. It's like, but it's just, oh, it's Jamie's kids. Whenever it's your company, you know, it's like it's a little bit more acceptable, or at least it's the beat of my own drum and I'm doing it. So that's been pretty cool. So that's probably, when you say the primary thing is, A, I felt there was a lot of opportunity. for what's out there and what could become. But then the most part is probably my kids.
Yeah, that's a good motivating factor.
Yeah, it's easy whenever it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
So.
Cool. We're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more with Jamie from Twisted Development. Hey everyone, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing, here with Jamie Ellis. Let me ask you this, dude. Starting a new business, going from being a mechanic, you know, contract worker for other people, to starting a business, there's like so much involved, right? That you probably didn't think of when you said, I'm going to start a company. What was the toughest part about it for you?
The accounting side. You know, you can't know what you know when you don't know it. And part of going into was like, I call them buckets for accounting. It's the easiest way you look at it. So it's like, whenever this money comes in, it needs to go into that bucket and that bucket and as far as that goes. So your chart of accounts is gnarly. Mm-hmm. All of our labor codes start with a one, so they're in the 1000s. All of our own part numbers start in the twos, which are 2000s. Mm-hmm. But then the world doesn't line up that way. So if there's a part you use from someone else that's in the twos or whatever, and then, you know, we wanted to grow the thing to have like sales certificates, and you know, so we're not paying sales tax on everything, so it doesn't. And then you know, so all of that trackability and everything, and then there's a huge fear of taxes. You know, because you've never done it before. You turns out you might be pretty good at working on an engine, but now you have to manage, obviously, paying bills, whatever it would be. So that curve is really steep from the aspect of how many other things go into it. And then, you know, we started in 2014, so we're some years in now. Yeah. And every year, you know, we have a couple week paid vacation. We have sick time. We have all this stuff where, like, it feels good. It feels like adulting.
Yeah.
You know, because it's like you're going against, you want to keep your staff. And it seems so far-fetched. Like I started in my garage. I had a porting bench that I bought off of eBay or whatever it would be. And then I put lights in the garage because I couldn't see. And then, you know, before I know it, I had somebody coming over to the house and work and customers were showing up to the house, whatever. So then transitionally, I started with a half a unit with Hoodie, DT1 mm-hmm. filters. Mm-hmm. He was cleaning filters in one half and working on bikes, so I built a diner room there. And then I said, Hoodie, it's either me or you. Like, one of us has to move.
Yeah.
And he's like, well, you have the dyno set up. It just makes sense that I move. I'm like, thank you. So then he moves. And so now I'm in four of those units.
Yeah.
So I just kind of keep taking over as he go. But once again, I'm to that moment where it's like being a business in Southern California, real estate's like $200 a square foot. So you want to get a building like even of this size, you know, this building would probably, what he sell it for $700,000, $800,000, $900,000, if not more. And so it doesn't really add up where you can get it for like $50 a square foot on the East Coast. So it has its challenges, and they've been fun. And you have that urge to like want to do better, you know? So every year we're taking on more machines, more services in-house. But then also too, the more you take on as an engine builder company is that like an engine builder across town isn't gonna bring their cylinder heads to me, because I'm an engine builder and I'll see what they're doing. Mm-hmm. So then it becomes like there's $100,000 machine sitting in the shop, and you don't, you know, luckily we might have enough work for it. But however, now you have to put a $50,000 to $70,000 staff running that machine, mm-hmm. and then you're not gonna get any of the competition's business.
Yeah.
So it just always is like really exciting to figure out what you can pull off, and the numbers of going back to the accounting becomes mm-hmm. really important. But yeah, I mean, we just try hard. We try to not screw anybody over. Just shoot it straight. Like our tagline is honesty, integrity, power. And yeah. with that being said, if you stay within those three words, the customers are going to get a fair shake. They're going to get what they're looking for. And that's really what we try the yeah. most for. And I'd say the biggest thing about whenever you're starting, you know, you don't really have margins in place. You don't know what it takes to one for the house, one for the bills, one, for, you know, mm-hmm. all of those things. So that's the worst part. And it's like these guys that are just starting or whatever, like I feel for them, because we've have like enough workflow coming in at this point where we're making margin, as we should, as mm-hmm. a business should make margins on some of their parts. That's what a business is. And whenever you do that, if one of my mechanics messes up or something like that, we have some room, you yeah. know, we have some money in the bank, we can cover the, you know, so it's not like a, well, did you warm the bike up, or yeah. one of those scenarios where it's like you try to put it back on the guy. Like we don't do that whatsoever. So we just try to let everything naturally flow through as far as what's going on, and evaluate mm-hmm. each situation as it goes. But it's definitely been challenging.
Where did you get the name Twisted?
So funny story is my wife and I had a bunch of wine, and I had a notepad, and it was the goal to write down as many business names as possible.
Okay.
And this is my philosophy. I just did it again for another business we're starting. But you just write down anything that comes to mind. Because in today's age, with the internet only being so old, there's a lot of names that are taken.
Yeah.
You know, so you can have a bunch of really cool ideas, like Precision comes up a lot, you know, like, but there's also a lot of those companies that are already Precision this, Precision
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
And I never wanted it to be Jamie Ellis Performance, because I always wanted to grow it into something better than just mm-hmm. my name, and something that maybe one day I could sell off or give to my kids or whatever turns into. At least at that point, it's not attached to one individual. And that was always the goal. So basically Twisted Development came up in a bunch of other ones, but the next day I researched every website that was available. And that was a process of elimination on how yeah. to get to something, because—
But your website isn't Twisted Development.
So there is two. There's twisteddevelopmentracing.com.
Okay.
But then there's I think that's way too much.
Okay.
And you can't put that on anything. So td-racing.com. Is it abbreviated? So if you go twisteddevelopmentracing.com, it's okay. gonna take, I bought both domains. So it'll just throw you to the other site. Yeah, and it's a little bit, you could see it on a swing arm, you could see it on a business card, but it's a kind of a big ordeal, I felt. So
yeah,
I went ahead and just locked in both. So one way or another, you kind of get there.
Yeah, it's kind of funny, because when I had my guys and I, we had that crazy transitional period in our mm-hmm. lives where—
We talked a lot about that.
Trans world was pulled out from under us.
Yeah.
I remember you called, hey dude, I don't think you should call it Swapmoto Live. And I was like, well, we already have the show, and it's yeah. already got some clout, and that was just what we went with. You're all, you should never name it after yourself. And I'm like, well,
there's a celebrity yeah. with you to respect.
Yeah. Well, no,
but I've tried to like hide myself underneath that yeah. and never wanted
so
to be.
So now it's funny, because Mike Antonovich, you know, one of my partners,
who's a talented
individual, he's doing awesome,
yeah.
right? And sometimes I feel like, I think about you. I think about what you said to me, and I'm yeah. like, man, I feel bad that Anton, who's amazing, yeah. is in the press conference saying, Anton with Swapmoto Live. Like, yeah, I don't ever call myself Swap or Swapmoto.
Yeah.
I'm Don to my friends, right?
Yeah.
But so Anton and I were joking around. I'm like, we'll just shorten it. We'll start calling it SML more and more, and then we just say that means Supercross Motocross Lifestyle. Kind of cheesy, but
no, it makes sense. But you're right, and that's the thing. It's like you end up with some very talented individuals as hopefully they gravitate to what you're doing.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it does feel douchey, like,
yeah,
you know, and I struggle with it a little bit because marketing the company, and whenever we would meet with someone to like redesign the website or whatever, they're like, but there is some sort of a celebrity here we need to respect. And I'm like, no, there's not.
Oh, come on, there is, man.
I don't want to be that guy. I would rather the business and its individuals of talented core group of people. Like, you know, some people still think that, I mean, I couldn't do everything that we do. You know, there's no way. Mm-hmm. I have good guys that are with us, and that's how we've been successful and got to where we're doing what we're doing.
Yeah, I'm blessed to have a great team with me. But hey, on that note, we're going to take one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for one more segment with Jamie Ellis.
Together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet, designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated, and it looks good.
It's hard to put our adventures on hold, but now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products, and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and FMF Racing. Here with Jamie Ellis of Twisted Development Racing. The one thing you've become known for is you're like the guy all the factory riders come to when they have to build their own bike, right? Like when Davey Millsaps lost his job, he came straight to you, had you build that badass Suzuki. Mm-hmm. Justin Barsha didn't have a ride, he came straight to you, had him build that Honda. That's got to feel pretty good that you have that reputation is like the guy to come to, top-notch engine building.
Yeah, it does. And also, too, I would say that we have been gifted a lot of those really good dudes. And I think one of the reasons is we can control a lot of the process. Like, we do the engine building, we do the mapping, we do, we're all, like, an all-in-one where there's not a ton of us out there that can do every step of the process, whether it be scheduling the workflow or whatever it would be. But yeah, so it's that whole thing is like platform for success is one of our other Instagram tags that I think is cool, because it's like whenever Brock Tickle or one of those guys comes over, it's our ultimate job is to get them back into a paid scenario. Mm-hmm. It's like pulling blood out of a turnip to get money out of these guys after they've been racing for so long and have just been making a couple hundred grand. Now they find themselves to not have much. So it is one of the things that I enjoy the most is to like give somebody something that they can go back out and earn a factory team. So it's like, it's never a goal to keep them on privateer equipment, because we can provide an engine, we can provide support at a short term, we can provide a lot of that stuff and coddle them to get them to where they need to be. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, a race team is gonna develop more, whether it be foot peg height or subframe height or handlebars or, you know, all of those things. And it does make a big difference that these teams have these individualized mechanics that are going to the track with them. And literally the guy shows up, can ride his motos and get back out of there, get to training. And it's like, that's such a benefit when you don't have to worry about the truck going to the next round or whatever it would be. So with that being said, it's always been our goal to just get them there, move them on, get them back into a paying job. And as if we give them the equipment they need to do the job, like it's just fun. You know, you get to work with some of these guys. Like Barsha was a dream. We had a couple settings that were going to make the bike faster, and we started out with a pretty mellow package. And he's like, "Dude, this thing's already so good." And you know, he went out and had a good weekend, and he earned himself a job again. Mm-hmm. But that was a pretty interesting topic too. So Yamaha had offered him like 20 grand or something the week of Monster Cup. Mm-hmm. And he was already so far down the road with us, so far down the road that, it got weird. And it was like, well, if you can't contract me for next year, you know, I don't think I'm going to sign or whatever. So it ended up, he did race the Honda at that race, but Yamaha was already hot after him, trying to get him to race their bike because they didn't have anyone. So there's always some fun behind the scenes stuff like that that happens that people don't hear about or know about.
Is it kind of crazy to look back at, say, the tuning you were doing with Yamaha Troy even, right? Mm-hmm. And the technology and how far it's come, you know, with EFI is huge, right? And you're one of the masters in our industry of EFI and the mapping and all that stuff, but there's so much more involved in building a great motorcycle now than there was 10 years ago.
Yeah, 100%. Like, I don't know when we get to drive-by-wire and some other stuff like that. When we were on carburetors, fuel injection felt so far away. I genuinely think that the motorcycle industry is about 10 years behind, you know, cars. And it's like, if you think of, like, I always like to use this analogy, like the spy world, you know, a spy back in the day would have a camera that would, you know, catch something cool and then they could show it to somebody else for evidence or whatever. And now that's organically happening in a pin pocket or whatever. So it's like, as technology evolves, you know, motorcycles evolve, like, compact fuel injection is a thing now. It's standard on every motorcycle that exists of the racing level, should we say. But drive-by-wire is a whole nother thing that sport bikes are already on too, and you know, lean angle and more sensors, and then you have dirt and water and mud and all of these things. So I don't know how far motorcycles go. I think it's a good thing to think about. But drive-by-wire is in a lot of other industries already. They can limit the power output. It does have some features. You know, you can clamp the thing wide open and it only go a quarter, or the rate of opening, or, you know, there's a lot of other stuff you can do there. So interesting enough, you know, somebody's going to do it. We'll see. It's already in, you know, Stasix and a lot of other little motorcycles. Yeah. So we'll see how that goes.
What is your thought about, like, electric bikes, right? Is it the future? Well, and if it is the future, like, how do you feel about it? Because, like, I know I've, you know, Donnie Emler at FMF is just like, oh, Alta suck.
Yeah.
You know, because, like, you can't put a pipe on Alta.
So that's an interesting topic. And being an electric bike owner, my kid's 7. And, you know, doing KJSC next year would be a huge goal. So, like, you have to be riding, racing, have a report, have a good report card and everything to even qualify for KJSC. So there's a lot of cool incentive to that. But we're 2 weeks into riding an e-bike now. And it's funny because I'm at the track. I went to Glen Helen last weekend. And I'm looking down. I've got a can of C12 because I brought my CR125, a can of T4 because I brought, and I have a box generator with the electric charger and a generator. And I'm like, they happen to all come out of the van and get sat next to each other. And I'm like, and even yet, like we rode this past Saturday, and he's not advanced. He's just getting started. Mm-hmm. And so he can do a whole day on a battery charge right now if it tells you how slow he's going. Mm-hmm. But then it does scenario wise. I'm like, well, my wife can take him. And you know, you just push the button. He puts it on whatever mode he wants. And yeah, now they're going without me, and he has more opportunity as to, I'm not saying she couldn't start an engine bike, but it just makes it way easier. No, yeah, gas, no nothing. You just pretty much lube the chain. And
she's not going to spill gas in the back of the.
Yeah. So I think battery technology is what's going to curb or advance.
So are you going to start studying that kind of stuff?
100%. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know accessible, like what we'll be able to get to with those controllers or technology wise or whatever. And all that stuff's going to start coming out as well. Mm-hmm. I'd have to think that the lights class will be the first one to adapt, mm-hmm, which that unfortunately is our most important class as an engine, yeah, builder. We only get to build snow bikes and flat track bikes fast. 450 Supercross bikes, you know, you're pretty much scheduled what you're doing to them. You're not going for the fence. You're making, mm-hmm, them manageable and fast. But when it comes to snow bikes and flat track, like these guys want everything they can get.
Yeah.
So it's not a lot of market for a business like ours. So it just makes it difficult. So that if they do adapt and take over the lights class to the entry class, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, to run these electric bikes, 450s are probably going to end up with pistons for quite a bit longer. You know, so what does that turn into? Does it turn into the electric bike nationals? Remember the four-stroke nationals?
Yeah.
How those, yeah, were a thing? So, yeah, I think only time will tell. But battery technology is obviously happening at a rapid rate, and we'll see if they can get it to a sustainable, mm-hmm, last. So, like, I was at Loretta's last year, and I saw this kid led the whole race on the e-bike, 50. Uh-huh. On the last lap, it goes into limp mode. He ran through all of his power. So they're at 20 minutes right now,
yeah,
plus a lap. So the kid made it 20 minutes, but that plus lap, you know. Mm-hmm. So do you go down a couple modes to finish the moto, or what do you do?
Yeah.
So technology is just going to keep advancing, and we'll see how that goes. But it's smart the way they're doing it. I can't say that I'm totally against it, because we went to the track with a PW50 and a Stasic at Cahia, mm-hmm, and you've seen the kids track. It has some hills. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
My kids, for the first time, that's where we went, and they had rode the PW in the field a lot. I taught them about brakings. I taught them the fundamental. I wanted to control the experience so that they loved it,
yeah,
and could eventually love to, yeah, ride motorcycles, but didn't have to race. And they didn't want to do a lap on the PW. It's heavy. It's clunky. They're small kids.
Yeah.
And I sent them out on the Stasics. That turned straight into them doing laps on the PW right after. They're like, okay, yeah, now,
yeah,
I can go.
Yeah, it was a great transition.
So it dumbed down the process to the point where it's like, you know, you saw whenever Harley bought Stasic, I thought, okay, that's a good play. You get these people at least riding dirt bikes of sort.
Yeah.
And they've known the feeling. Mm-hmm. And so growing the brand, we do have to accept, or growing the industry of motorcycles, we do have to accept some electric bikes and the gateway, and then just keep to controlling the safe path of having people love the sport. And that's the ultimate goal. So it's like, with those things being said, I can't be against a motorcycle if it could potentially not catch up technology-wise in my, yeah, lifetime. So I'm maybe a little bit more open to it and understanding it may put me out of business. Mm-hmm. But I think at that time, you know, I'll just be the guy that works on engines still. You
know, like the vintage mechanic.
Yeah,
right?
We still, yeah, work on two-strokes all the time, like old two-strokes. Yeah. So I think there will be a place for us in the future. It may not be at the mainstream. I don't know what it's going to look like. I hope, mm-hmm, I hope we are. And if not, we'll adapt and work on electric. But only time will tell. And as that happens, you just got to keep evolving. And I mean, Twisted Development was kind of the idea of like, you never stop developing. You know, the ball's always moving. If, mm-hmm, if this is what you have today and somebody gets it and they copy it, well, you better be working on something better in the future. So like you never get left behind. Mm-hmm. So with that mentality, you know, you have to accept electric bikes. You have to just keep rolling.
Absolutely. Hey, we're just about out of time, but let's use this opportunity to like plug the biz, right? Like Jamie is well known for a high-end engine builder for the pro class, but anyone can call you, right?
Yeah. So we're in Marietta, California. We share a parking lot with KTM, and super resourceful. Interesting enough, we do Hayden Deegan's two strokes, and that's another thing I was going to talk to you about was Brian Deegan. So circling back to whenever I started the business, one of the key things that whenever, you know, I was thinking about, didn't know how to say, but at the time of leaving Rockstar Suzuki, which was Rockstar KTM, I had a job opportunity to work at Pro Circuit to be an engine builder there. I'd had a couple meetings with Mitch, and I still dream of working there. You know, like the race team, all of it, like they win championships. Mitch is a grinder. Like it's all outside looking in, you know. But with that being said, I had an opportunity to work there. And then I met with Brian Deegan a couple times, who was at the time racing trucks against Jeremy McGrath. And Hayden Deegan was on 4 to 6 year old 50s. And so basically Brian was like, look, dude, if you want to work, you know, I need all this stuff developed. You have a dyno. I could give you a small salary, but you're going to need to make the rest of your money. And I think you will. So circling back to how I started Twisted Development, like the path is a little bit different because I kind of had I had a customer. And to start a business, you have to have a customer. And luckily I had a repeat customer. So we've built Hayden Deegan's engines, Haley Deegan's engines, Brian Deegan's engines, whatever he wanted, I kind of dove into it and would help him with whatever it would be. Went truck racing, Haley won a championship in the mod carts. And then, and obviously Hayden's won multiple championships every year. So we've been building his stuff from 50 cc's all the way till currently 112s, you know, super minis and 125s. So my whole goal with Brian was always to keep Hayden up front winning with the best equipment until he transitions to a factory team. So keeping the platform for success dream alive. You know, I've won championships with him, which is cool for our company, and as well as transition them all the way through and then hand them off into good hands. So that was another opportunity. So I might have made it seem a little different, but I had a shored up customer. So I think that helps quite a bit.
That's awesome. Okay, so two stroke, four stroke, anything, call Twisted Development,
TD-Racing.com. Or TwistedDevelopmentRacing.com, the whole thing.
And you're going to take my 21KX 250 back to the shop with you right now, right?
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Awesome. Hey, Jamie, thanks for coming on, man.
Yeah.
It's been a pleasure getting to know you over the years and riding and all this stuff. So anyway, guys, thanks for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe to this video. Check out Twisted Development on the web and on Instagram. At
TwistedDevelopmentRacing.com. Twisted Development Racing. If you just search it, you're going to find it.
Nice.
Hard enough.
Guys, thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.